way, Lord, and give us tender hearts, Lord, that are able to feel and sense your presence, Jesus.
Yes.
I put that heavy burden you have taken to me, Jesus.
You have taken that burden.
Thank you, Jesus. You have it all together, Jesus. It's not anymore in Melissa's hands, and not anymore, Jesus.
These are his words, so that's really important.
Right.
These are his exact words. If you go back a little bit in Matthew, you'll see that this was part of his Sermon on the Mount.
Mm.
So at the very beginning of his ministry, he had just come out of the wilderness where he was tempted by Satan for 40 days. He learned that John the Baptist was arrested. And the Bible says that he began to heal people, and this word spread about that Jesus was healing people, and more people were coming from all over the land. And the beautiful thing is, it says that Jesus healed everybody that he came into contact with, which just touched my heart so much. I want to read the scripture again. It's Matthew 7:11. And in this particular portion, he was talking about praying, how to effectively pray. And this is the end of it. Actually, let me just read this whole portion here, Matthew 7:7-11. So Matthew 7:7-11, excuse me. Keep on asking and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking and you will find. Keep on knocking and the door will be open to you. For everyone who asks receives. Everyone who seeks finds. And everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. You parents, if your children ask for a loaf of bread, do you give them a stone instead? Or if they ask for a fish, do you give them a snake? Of course not. So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask Him?
Amen.
Yes. Yeah. So it's a beautiful analogy where he analyzes humanity with divinity. He specifically says, if you hard-hearted, sinful men know how to give good gifts. So he's implying that we know how to do this.
Right.
We don't always do it.
Yeah.
That little statement would suggest that maybe we don't always do it, but we do know how. Won't your Father in heaven even more certainly, and I began to look at these words, even more certainly, the meaning for that means to a higher degree, to a greater quantity. That's our God.
Mm-hmm.
He just doesn't do a little bit. He wants to go all the way.
Mm-hmm.
And giving good gifts. The gift in the scripture there means present, which I just love. It's not just a spiritual gift, but it can be a gift of any kind. Physical, emotional, or spiritual. It's beautiful. It's a present. God wants to give us presents, which is so wonderful. That might be hard to understand if you had a father who didn't, if you have some unresolved things with your dad, if you had a dad that wasn't able to show kindness or have a generous heart. And it might even be difficult to understand if maybe you haven't been a parent to understand the heart of a father for a child.
Mm-hmm.
He has given people the ability, the desire to give gifts to our children. And that's an inherent character of God. He put that in us. which is just beautiful. But when it comes to God the Father, He does that perfectly. There's nothing in the way. In man, there's maybe we don't have everything that we would like to give our children, so we can't give it fully, either tangibly or from the heart. But God's gifts are perfect, and He can give them. Sometimes He withholds them because maybe we're not ready yet. Maybe a gift could cause too much trouble for us in the moment. Maybe our character hasn't formed enough to be able to receive it. And I think that, it made me think, Lord, I want to be ready. You have all these beautiful gifts that you want to give. It's your heart to give, your character to do that. And what might not I not be able to receive right now? My heart isn't ready. So I'm hoping tonight that He'll talk with us and tell us what we need to hear so that our hearts are ready to receive all of the gifts that He has for us. So every gift that He has is good and perfect. Kana, who created all the lights in heaven? So God, it's also recognizing Him as creator. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow, which I'm so grateful. We don't have to guess what His motives are or what His agenda is. His character is plain for us to see, and we know that whatever He wants to give us is very good. In verse 18, it says, He chose to give birth to us by giving us His true word. And we, out of all creation, became His prized possessions. Those two sentences are so profound. He chose to give birth to us in a parental reference, right? Our parents give birth to us. God gave birth to us when we became His children through the Spirit, right? And that makes us legitimate children, which is amazing to me. And to top that all off, not only is He our Father and our real Father, but we are His prized possession. That blew me away. In all creation, everything He made, in the universe, the stars, the planets, the trees, the tedious little bug with all these working parts and how everything works together, and people, the ones who come to Him, are His prized possession. That speaks so much about the heart of the Father. James, a little further down, in 4:3, says that sometimes we don't receive because we might be asking with wrong motives. And that was another thing that I was hoping the Lord will do for us tonight. We all have desires, we all have wants. We have to make sure the motive behind the asking is pure, that what we want is what God wants, that that we're asking Him for His will, that we're asking Him ultimately so that the gift that we receive can be given back to Him. Our gifts are not for us alone, but for the Lord to receive honor, to receive glory. Jesus says, Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, how I desire to gather you up like a mother hen gathers her chicks. And that was another thing that spoke to me about the heart of God. A mother hen protects her chicks. There was a story about a village that was burned down in a war-torn area. And there was a chicken. She had been burned. She was dead and just charred. And somebody walked by and just kicked it. And out from under her wings were all her baby chicks. They were all okay, and they all ran away. And that image, so when Jesus said that, I desire to gather you up like a mother hen gathers her chicks, is speaks of his protection, his love, and that tenderness. And so we have this encouragement to ask him for what we need, to ask him for what we desire, to go to him. He wants us to ask. He's waiting. It's the relationship that allows the transfer of love, the transfer of gifts, and I'm hoping that tonight as well, that we'll be able to really get that and to come closer to the heart of God and to know him as Father, so that we can receive what it is that he has for us.
As you grow more in him and have more communication with him, you know that the first person you have to go is him. He's the one. So when you rely on him and you trust in him, you are full of peace. Any circumstance is going to push you down because he's there. And he's my first thing in my heart. So I don't have to be anxious, to be impatient, without peace, because he has given it before us. So you have to grow in that communication, to be unified with him in the same symptom. How do you say the same?
Frequency.
To that communion beautiful that goes and comes, and then you feel full. You don't need anything, and you only say, God, you know what I mean. You know everything. So I don't have to be worried for anything. It's beautiful.
We just simply don't ask. We don't ask. Oh, well, I don't deserve it. Or, oh, God's too busy, you know, for him to think about this little thing. And the Father is like, I want to show myself good to you, right? Mm-hmm. And they're ready. They're just ready. And those little details that make the relationship so real, right? Don't you love it when you have a need and you share it to the Lord, and it's in your mind, it's in your heart, and then all of a sudden he kind of whispers it into reality, and there it is in front of you, like, you know, and you recognize it's God, and you know it's him. It couldn't have been any other than him. It's happened to me so many times, and it just quickens your heart. That little whisper, I've got you covered, my son. You only knew the need, Lord, and you came through. And I want you to experience that, you know? And in the middle of trials, tribulations, the voice of the Father can become muffled, right? And the enemy amplifies his voice. He doesn't care about you. He's forgotten about you. You know, and so in those moments, we can't isolate. We have to be like, this is important because it amplifies the voice of God. And you come back home, okay, I got new doses of reality, you know. I'm
spiritual
gas station. Exactly.
Spiritual.
Yeah, go to the service station, get fueled again. So what are some roadblocks in your personal life? What keeps you from asking the Lord? What keeps us from asking? What keeps us from going to him as a child? Not as an orphan or a beggar, kind of like begging God, as if we had no rights as children. What keeps us? Come on.
Discouragement, like if we go through trials and we believe that God is not gonna help us. Just feeling like he's not as forgiving or as generous.
Yes. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find it. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or he asks for a fish, will you give him a snake? If you, then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children. Mm-hmm. How much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others what you would have do to you. For this sums up the law of the prophets. The law of the prophets.
Sometimes you're afraid to ask God because you think, well, he's just going to say no anyway. Mm-hmm. Or you think, I'm not worthy of what I'm asking for. And so you just say, I'm not going to bother asking because I don't deserve it anyway. Mm-hmm. Whatever, there's so many reasons that you put up that you make up in your own mind not to ask God about. You just want to keep it in your own little cubby hole inside and not let God. I think I saw it on the TV show, maybe it was on the radio, a guy was saying that, and I'll use Angel as an example. I invite Angel over to my house to stay. And I get up the next morning, take my shower, and I leave to go to work. I say, Angel, the house is yours, you do whatever you want with it. So he goes to go in the bathroom, but the door's locked. So that's kind of weird. So then he goes to the refrigerator, and there's a lock on the refrigerator. And he goes to turn the TV on, and there's a password he can't get in. And that's the same thing we do with God. We say, it's yours, God, come on in. But then you hide these little things from God, and he knows they're there, but you're trying to hide them and lock him away from those things. And that's one of the fears you have. That's why you don't ask, because you think that might open the door to see what's going inside you.
Confessing your sins to your brother, because, you know, for me, that's the biggest thing for me. It's been since you gave that sermon about it, like, 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And the freedom that comes from that, the accountability that comes from that is just beyond understanding. Like, literally pouring yourself out, making yourself vulnerable, which we have similar backgrounds, so you know that for us, that's like a no-no, you know? And then actually following through with God's plan and following that, it was a freedom that I still to this day can't understand myself. It's just a blessing to see that in confessing that to my brothers and sisters and having that accountability, God is edified in that because I'm humbling myself for him. It's just, it's a blessing.